Okay, good morning, students. Today,
good morning, ma'am.
I just revised the fourth module, all the topics very quickly so that you will be able to read on that. Can you see the presentation?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, in this fourth module, we have concentrated more on the design of HDFS and the HDFS concepts, namely blocks, name nodes and data nodes, HDFS federation, HDFS high availability, and failover and fencing mechanisms in order to remove the single point of failure that is caused by the name node. Now, HDFS is a file system designed for storing very large files with streaming data access patterns running on clusters of commodity hardware. This is the definition which better explains about the architecture of HDFS. In this, they have highlighted three terms: very large files, streaming data access, and commodity hardware. Very large files means this architecture supports large volumes of data, storing and processing large volumes of data. And streaming data access means the data can be streamed continuously. It need not be a static data. It can be dynamic. Not only historic data is analyzed, but even the dynamically generated data is also analyzed by using this HDFS architecture. And the commodity hardware. Commodity hardware states that the hardware that is used to set up the data centers in order to host this HDFS clusters, it is very economic in cost. The organizations need not start planning for it well ahead for some budget approvals. This is very economically available by deploying commodity hardware, less costly hardware. And HDFS is not a good fit for some scenarios like where the data latency is, where the low latency of data access is actually bottleneck. Means you should not have the data access speed to be very low. If you want to compromise with analysis, but you don't want to compromise with speed, in that case, low latency data access is required. Means in that case, HDFS is not a good fit. And lots of small files, if they are present, in that case also HDFS may not be a good fit. Why? Because lots of small files can easily be analyzed by using some traditional processing techniques. For this, you need not go for MapReduce techniques. And even restoring their metadata will be an overhead for HDFS if there are lots of small files. Name node will be crowded with this metadata itself, metadata of the small files itself. That is why in where there are lots of small files, in such cases, HDFS may not be a good fit. And even multiple writers and arbitrary file modifications. If multiple writers have to work in order to write the data to the file system, or if arbitrary file modifications are required, random file modifications are required. If you want to modify the file somewhere in the middle, not at the end exactly, how is supported by HDFS? In such cases, this HDFS again is not a good fit for the problem. Now we also have understood about how data is how file is divided into blocks of data. File is not stored as it is on HDFS clusters. They are divided into smaller units. The least data unit of transfer on this Hadoop platform, that is the block. A disk has a block size, which is the minimum amount of data that it can read or write. So the file systems for a single disk build on this by dealing with data in the form of blocks. and file system blocks are typically a few kilobytes in size, whereas disk blocks are normally 512 bytes by default. In file systems, if you take the size of data blocks are little smaller, but when you take the disk blocks, they are of default size around 512 bytes. And there are tools to perform file system maintenance such as DF and FSeq that operate on the file system at the block level in order to seek whatever is present in the directory, to list out all the files in the directory, and to free the disk space. For all this, you can use tools like DF and FSeq. Now, block in HDFS is a much larger unit. Now, on a file system, it is very small unit, and on disks and disk system, the amount of storage is 512 bytes, right? Yeah, 512 bytes. But if you are storing data on a block in HDFS, then it is a much larger unit. Though it is treated as a block, still the basic block size is around 64 MB by default. And this can be increased based on the requirement. Now, in a file system for a single disk, files in HDFS are broken into block-sized chunks. Means each chunk will be minimum a block size, which are stored as independent units. And also their replication factor is maintained. Unlike a file system for a single disk, a file in HDFS is smaller than a single block, does not occupy a full block's worth of underlying storage. If you take a file system for a single disk, then it occupies the entire disk space. But a file in HDFS that is smaller than a single block does not occupy a full block's worth of underlying storage. If you want to store many other blocks on that particular node, still it is possible. And what is the benefit of this block abstraction for DFS? Why do we need to treat the unit of data storage or transfer as a block? What is the advantage? A file can be larger than any single disk in the network, right? A file need not be accommodated only on a single disk. Though it is larger, they will be divided into number of blocks and spread across the cluster. And making the unit of abstraction a block rather than a file simplifies the storage subsystem, because you can't actually calculate how many files can be accommodated on a data node. Why? Because some file may be of smaller length and some files may be of larger length. But if you divide them into blocks of standard size, then you can easily calculate how many blocks a data node can accommodate. Right, that is the advantage of block abstraction. And even blocks fit well with replication for providing fault tolerance and availability. If you want to replicate the blocks, if you want to replicate the copies of the file, you can easily do that in the form of blocks. And this provides a mechanism for fault tolerance and availability of the data 24/7 all the time. And HDFS FSeq command understands the data storage in the form of blocks only. Now, for example, if you want to run this command, %Hadoop FSeq --files/blocks, this will list the blocks that make up each file in the file system, right? So that you will know how to reconstruct, if at all the file has to be constructed back, you will know where exactly the blocks of data are stored. Now, we have also seen other important components under this HDFS. They are name nodes and data nodes. These are the essential components where exactly the data is stored and the analysis process is based on. So an HDFS cluster has two types of nodes operating in a master worker pattern, right? So what is master and what is worker here? Can the students answer me? Which component is treated as a master and which component as a worker? When you consider the name nodes and data nodes on HDFS, which is treated as master and which is treated as a worker? Are you there, students?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, name node as a master and data node as a worker.
Very good. And the name node also manages the file system namespace stored persistently on the local disk in the form of two files. So the name node is responsible to maintain two different files by the names, the namespace image, and the edit log. Very important to remember. Name node manages the file system namespace stored persistently on the local disk. It is stored permanently on the local disk in the form of two different files. They are namespace image and the edit log. The name node also knows the data nodes on which all the blocks for a given file are located. Remember, name node doesn't actually store the blocks of data, but it stores the details about where the blocks of data is stored, so that whenever it has to perform some analysis, it can quickly reconstruct that entire file from the blocks stored at various nodes. Okay, so the name node should know about the data nodes on which all the blocks for a given file are located. And a client accesses the file system through an interface on behalf of the user by communicating with the name node and data nodes, right? The client has to access the file system through an interface. They can't directly interact with the name node and data node. They interact through an interface on which actually interacts with the name nodes and data nodes on behalf of the users. And data nodes are the actual workhorses of the file system. They take up the actual task of processing or reading or writing the data. So they store and retrieve blocks when they are told to, either by the client or by the name node. Sometimes the clients may want to directly read the data. So the HDFS client, as you have seen in the anatomy of file read and write, it communicates with the name node as well as the data nodes in order to read the relevant data that is expected by HDFS client. Now, without the name node, the file system can't be used. Why? Because the name node is like a address holder where it has the details of entire file system where the blocks of data are stored on various data nodes. Now, if the machine running the name node was obliterated or destroyed, then all the files on the file system would be lost, right? If a name node failure occurs, then there is a danger of losing the entire metadata where the actual blocks of data are stored on the data nodes. So what is the solution for this? How can we achieve name node resilience to failure? Hadoop provides two mechanisms in order to overcome this failure situation, that is backing up the files and running a secondary name node. Let's see how it is done. Now, backing up the files happens one at the same data center and one at a remote place by using remote processor calls. So it will try to replicate the data on a different network file system so that whenever the name node fails, it will try to recover the replica of those blocks of data from the remote place through the network file system. And also it runs a secondary name node. This secondary name node is simply another node where this copy of the metadata is stored. And when the name node is failed, then the control will be transferred to this secondary name node, where the secondary name node will be up in a very less amount of time and starts running and serves as the primary name node. But still, there will be a lag between primary name node and the secondary name node. That is why there is a chance of losing the data in some system failure cases. Let's see in the later parts how it can be overcome by using failover and fencing mechanisms. Now, this HDFS federation is another important feature introduced into Hadoop 2.x release, and the name node in this case keeps a reference to every file and block in the file system in memory. Now, HDFS federation allows a cluster to scale by adding name nodes. So you need not worry about whether the name node will be overcrowded or what. Whenever the demand arises in order to increase the scalability, in order to increase the processing capacity of the cluster, then you can easily keep adding various data nodes and also keep track of those name nodes by adding multiple data nodes. In previous case, only one name node used to take care of the entire metadata of the data stored on the cluster. But due to this introduction of HDFS federation feature, it allows a cluster to scale by adding name nodes, extra name nodes, multiple name nodes, each of which manages a portion of the file system namespace. Here, the file system namespace is divided into different parts, and each file system that is evolving out of a particular root directory will be saved under one designated name node, so that each name node need not store the entire cluster's metadata. Now, under federation, each name node manages a namespace volume. Again, this is another important term to be remembered. Each namespace manages a namespace volume, which is made up of the metadata for the namespace and also a block pool containing all the blocks for the files in the namespace. So this block pool contains all the blocks that are distributed across the data nodes under this particular name node. Okay, and namespace volumes are independent of each other. One name node doesn't communicate in any way with the other name node. Only when failure occurs, then other name node have to substitute the failed name node. Until then, no communication for the data transfer occurs between the name nodes. That is multiple name nodes that are deployed. And to access a federated HDFS cluster, clients use client-side mount tables to map file paths to name nodes. All the file paths have to be properly mapped to the name node so that it will be easy for the name node to reconstruct the files when they are requested by the client. And this is managed in configuration using view file system and the URI using viewfs and the designated URI, whichever URI you have to give in order to access that file system. Now, what are the concepts that we have gone through in the second lecture of this module? Let's see. Okay, again, in this part of the lecture, we have seen about HDFS high availability and the failover and fencing mechanisms, along with how to use the command line interface to interact with the HDFS cluster. Okay, in the previous lecture, we have discussed all these. In the first part of today's revision class, we have discussed all these blocks, name nodes and data nodes, and how name node achieves resilience to failures by adding multiple name nodes in the form of HDFS federation. And now let's see how high availability is ensured by this HDFS. The combination of replicating name node metadata on multiple file systems and using the secondary name node to create checkpoints protects against the data loss, but it does not provide high availability of the file system, right? So whenever the name node is down, before the secondary name node takes over, there will be a little lag. But how is high availability being ensured by this HDFS? Always this name node is a single point of failure in this case also. So in such an event, the whole Hadoop system would effectively be out of service until a new name node could be brought online, because there will be some time delay when the secondary name node takes up the responsibility of the primary name node. When this happens, there will be a small time delay. But how would high availability be ensured in this case? The new name node will not be able to serve the request in case of the primary name node's failure until it has loaded its namespace into the memory and replayed its edit log, so that if there are any data that is pending to be written to the disk on the HDFS cluster, that log have to be replayed in order to ensure that new updates are not lost before the secondary name node takes up the responsibility of the primary name node. So the data has to be loaded, the namespace image has to be loaded into the memory, and it has to replay all its edit log and receive enough block reports from the data nodes in order to leave it safe mode and run exactly as a name node. So in this case, it takes some time in order for a secondary name node to take up when the primary name node fails. So on large clusters with many files and blocks, the time it takes for a name node to start from cold state, that is from a passive state, can be 30 minutes or more in some cases. So this will cause a bad experience with the business where the data center can't ensure high availability. So what is the solution for this? The 2.x release series of Hadoop remedies this situation, provides a solution for this situation by adding support for HDFS high availability. In this implementation, there is a pair of name nodes in an active and standby configuration. Understand this carefully. There is a pair of name node and a pair of name nodes which stands in a two-state configuration. That is the active configuration and the standby configuration. Means the name node one will be active all the time, and another name node will be in a passive state, will be in a standby state, so that whenever the primary name node failure occurs, then immediately this standby name node will resume its operations without creating any lag in the name node services. Now, a few architectural changes are needed in order to allow this to happen. The name nodes must use highly available shared storage to share the edit log, and even the data nodes must send the block reports to both the name nodes at frequent intervals of time, and clients must be configured to handle name node failovers, and if the active name node fails, the standby should be able to take over very, very quickly, so that this availability will not be non-availability will not be experienced by the business users. And also we have discussed about failover and fencing mechanisms, which can be quickly plugged into the current architecture, so that each node, a name node, runs a lightweight failover controller process whose job is to monitor its name node for failover and trigger a failover should a name node fail, so that immediately the standby name node can take up the responsibility. Okay, and in this case, we discussed about two kinds of failovers. One is a graceful failover, which is planned by the administrator in case of some routine maintenance to see whether the active node name node and the standby name node are working properly or not in case of a failure. That is planned maintenance. But in case of graceful failover, means which is not expected, it is impossible to be sure that the failed name node has stopped running or not, because sometimes it takes more time for the name node to respond. In that case, it can be treated that the name node has failed. So the Hadoop high availability feature implements a method known as fencing in this case. So the system employs a range of fencing mechanisms, which actually kills the name nodes process if at all it has a doubt that it has failed, but it didn't fail. By the time the standby name node has taken over, in that case, it kills the name nodes process and revoke its access to shared storage directory, and it disables its network port via a remote management command. And also, the previously active name node can be fenced with a technique known as stonit, that is, shoot the other node in the head. Means it will cancel the name node that is running with lethargically, so that the standby name node can take over the actual operations. Now, client failover is handled transparently by the client library, and the simplest implementation uses client-side configuration to control the failover. We have also seen command line interface through which we can the client can actually interact with the HDFS cluster. In this case, there are two properties that have to be set. One is the default name, and the other one is the replication factor. In this case, we have shown you how to run only on a single machine, not on multiple machines on a cluster. That is why you are setting up the machine in a pseudo distributed mode. That is the reason to set this default replication factor to 1. Otherwise, it will be expecting the default replication factor to be 3. And whenever the default replication factor is not met, it will raise some warnings continuously. In order to avoid that and to state that we are working in a pseudo distributed mode, we are setting the replication factor to 1. And also the default file system, default name of the file system can be set to localhost, which is used to set a default file system for Hadoop. Now in the coming up topics, we also discussed about HTTP, C and Fuse. Let's go through that. Okay, we have also seen basic file system operations in this part and Hadoop file systems along with the interfaces used to interact with the HDFS. Now in basic file system operations, we have seen two operations. One is to copy a file from the local file system to HDFS file system, and another operation to copy back the file from HDFS file system back to your local file system. For that, we have seen two commands. One is percentage Hadoop, which indicates that we are running in a Hadoop environment, file system hyphen copy from local, which copies the data, which copies the file from the local file system. And remember here, your HDFS is also on your local file system. That is why you are indicating as local host. Okay. Local system, not local file system. HDFS is also on your local system. That is why you are using local host. So when you're copying the file, you're using copy from local command to read the file from the local file system. This is the path of the file from your local file system, and that you're copying onto HDFS file system. Now, in this case, we can omit the scheme and host of the URI and pick up the default HDFS local host. Why? Because we are both are being run on the same local system. That is why we can modify the same command like this. Using copy from local, we can give the local file system's path, and you can omit HDFS localhost URI so that you can assume that you are working on the same machine. with HDFS also. That is why you can directly give the path to which the data has to be written onto HDFS. And we also could have used a relative path and copied the file to our home directory in HDFS, which is in this case user tom, so that directly we can use input docs, take it from the local file system and copy it onto HDFS file system. Because the relative path is user tom and it is copied, and that is the home directory in HDFS, you can skip that path and directly give quangle.txt, that is name of the text file into which the data has to be copied. Now, once the data is copied from local file system onto your HDFS, let us perform another operation to copy that HDFS file from the HDFS file system back to your local file system. For that, what is the command we use? Copy to local. In order to copy from local, we are using copy from local command, but you are now copying from HDFS to your local system. So you are using copy to local. You are reading from this quangle.txt and you're creating a new copy on your local file system, that is quangle.copy.txt. Now let us perform this message digest algorithm, which will try to compare the hash keys obtained in both these operations in order to see whether the data is consistent even after copying it back from the, copying it onto HDFS and then copying it back to local file system, whether the data is intact or not. For that, the message digest 5 algorithm is implemented and the hash keys obtained from your local file system original copy and the copy of the local file after taking it from the HDFS back again. For that, it is observed that both the keys are same, which indicates that the data is intact and not corrupted. The data is safely copied onto HDFS and back to your local file system again. Now finally, let's look at a HDFS file listing. This is same as your Unix command. If you want to create a new directory, you can use hadoopfs hyphen make directory. Now you're creating a new directory books. Now in order to list what is there in that file system, you can use hyphen ls in order to list the contents of that file system. So you can see here, you have a directory by the name books, which you created right now. And even the file, the original file from which you actually tried to copy it onto HDFS cluster. So I also explained you what are these components of this entire text that is displayed here. The first one is the file permissions. The second one is the replication factor. For the file directory, for the directory, there is no replication factor need to be maintained. So it is just empty. But for a file, the replication factor we have set here is 1, because you are running only on a one machine and you can't create multiple copies. And this is the owner, this is the group to which it belongs, and the last updated time of this directory and file, and the absolute path where exactly you find this directory and the file. Now we have also gone through various types of Hadoop file systems, which are concrete implementations of the abstract class org.apache.hadoop.fs. file system. Okay, so these are various abstractions: local, HDFS, HFTP, HSFTP, which gives us secured file transfer protocol, and web HDFS, which is built over HFTP and HSFTP in order to provide some additional features like Kerberos authentication, and Hadoop archive in order to archive your data on the clusters, and KFS cloud store, FTP, S3 native, which actually runs on Amazon S3, and S3 block-based distributed RAID, which provides for HDFS replication, and the view file system, which is a client-side mount table for other Hadoop file systems. Okay. Now we have also seen various types of interfaces available in order to interact with HDFS. We know that we can do it with, through Java, and also we can have two ways of accessing HDFS over HTTP. That is directly where the HDFS daemons serve HTTP requests to clients. There is no mediator in between. And sometimes you can also see architectures where a proxy is deployed, which accesses HDFS on the client's behalf using the usual distributed file system API. So introducing this kind of proxy in the middle will help to implement some security and firewall mechanisms in place in order to assign some more security to the architecture. That is depicted here in this picture. And also, we have gone through different types of interfaces available, that is C, Fuse, file system, in user space. And in the later lectures, we have seen how to read data from a Hadoop URL and using file system API. Let's go through those topics also. Okay, in this we have gone through other topics like reading data from Hadoop URL directly. How we can do that, I have explained you with a template. We can just create an input streams object. Initially, it is not connected to any input stream, but later we can connect it to the file path from which the data has to be read. And you should also have a finally block in order to close the input stream that has been opened. And this is enabled by close stream method of IO utilities class. I think you will be able to recollect what all discussed in the actual lectures by seeing this template, so that we can quickly go through. And this example shows a program for displaying files from Hadoop file systems on standard output, so that you can read the data from the Hadoop files and display it onto the screen. For that, again, for every read and write operation, you need to open input stream and output stream objects. Okay, in this case, you opened the input stream object and you connected it to a file. And by using the copy bytes method of IO utilities, you're reading the data into the input stream and finally closing the input stream, which can further be read later and written onto the standard output. Now we are using this command to run those files that are created by using URL cat command. URL cat command, HDFS, use the localhost and give the file name, which actually reads the data from the Hadoop file system and displays it onto the screen. Okay, that is done by using this copy bytes method. It is reading the data from the input stream that is connected to the file and reading it to the system output, writing it to the system output by copy bytes method. And this is the buffer size, and this is to whether implicitly close the input stream. If it is not implicitly closed, then we have to close it in the finally block. Okay, so understand this syntax carefully. IO utilities will call the copy bytes method in order to read the data from the input stream that is already read from the file and write it to the standard output by the buffer size. By maintaining this buffer size means up to how many bytes the data can be accumulated in order to flush it to the standard output. Okay, and this is the default action to be taken, whether to close the input stream or not. Because we have given it false here, It can't be implicitly closed. We have to close it explicitly by using the finally block. And that is how the file is run and the data is displayed onto the standard output. That is your screen. Now we also have another mechanism to read the data using the file system API directly. For that, we used get method, which has various types of overloaded descriptions. One which uses the configuration object, which actually has the configuration details of the client and the server, and it sometimes takes the URI also. And it in other version, it takes the username, and sometimes it just reads from the local file system by using get local method instead of a get method. Okay, so these are various representations of open method again, which can be used along with FS data in which returns FS data input stream object, so that the data can be read from that input stream and displayed onto the standard output. For that, program has been mentioned here. Again, the mechanism is that the methodology is the same. You have to take the URI that is mentioned at the command line argument and create a configuration object to encapsulate the client server configurations, and create a file system object by getting the URI from the command line and create the input stream here and connect it to the file URI that is specified in the command line and read the data from it, write it to the output stream by using the copy bytes method and explicitly close the input stream object. Okay, this is how you need to read the data by using file system API. And when we are discussing about this, we have seen how FS data input stream object will help us, and even the FS data output stream also in the next lecture. They are very easy code to understand. They are written in Java. So if you have any doubts, you can ask me personally or now itself, not a problem. Why? Because we have to just cover some more things before stopping today. Okay, and later we have paid attention to this writing data onto a file system in HDFS cluster and FS data output stream, how it is used while writing the data and various directory options. Writing the data is also very simple, right? It actually implements a programmable interface which keeps track of how much data is written onto the file in the Hadoop file, HDFS file system, so that we can quickly understand the status of the file write operation. For that, again, I have given a small snippet of Java code. This is very clear to understand, right? You're taking the local source file, the file path to the local source, and the destination where the data has to be written. And you're creating a input stream which is being connected to the buffered input stream, which is using the new instance of the file stream that is connected with your local source from which you're reading the data and writing it onto the file on HDFS. And configuration object is compulsory because it has the details of client server configuration, and create a file system object which gets the data from the destination, creates a file system path to the destination file by using create method of URI. And it also creates the output stream object through which the data has to be written to the destination file. And we are trying to override the progress method that is defined in the interface, programmable interface, that is declared in the programmable interface. You are trying to redefine that one by using just dot, which indicates as long as the process is going on, it just indicates the progress. Okay, and finally, you're trying to read the data from the local source and write it to the destination file on a file system in HDFS by using copy bytes method. And for that, you are using this command to run the file in order to read it from the local host and write it onto the HDFS cluster. Notice the URI in this case. Here you are reading it from the local file by using file copy with progress and calling that class and using this URI to indicate that this is being written onto a file system on the HDFS cluster, which is hosted on your local host itself, because you're working on one single machine at present. And in this process, we have understood what are the services given by FS data output stream. This actually helps us to get the position from where which has a method. This create method on file system returns the FS data output stream, which is same as FS data input stream, that has a method for querying the current position in the file. Why? Because the file, the data that is going to be written onto the file on HDFS cluster, it will start appending at the end. It doesn't have this HDFS cluster doesn't support random writes. So whatever file is being written, that data will be written only at the end of the file where the current position of the file is. That is why it has to keep track of that position where the current file pointer is, so that the data can be appended at that particular part. It will not rewrite the existing file contents. And also, we have seen some commands to create the directories by using mkdirs. It is very simple to understand. And the topics in the next part. We have seen how to query the file system. Means in order to know what is the file status, whether the data is written safely or not, whether the required amounts of data is properly written to the file on the file system or not. In order to know the file status, what are various commands available? We have seen in this querying the file system topic. The file system class encapsulates file system metadata for files and directories, including various details like file length, block size, replication factor, modification time, ownership, and the permission information. All these can be obtained by querying the file system through getFileStatus method. For that, I have shown you how to use assert that method in order to get various status of the file. Assert that will compare what you expect and what is actually existing in the file system, so that if both are true, then that command will be successful, indicating that the file operation is done successfully. And listing the files by using list status method, we have seen, so that it lists the status of all the files. If you want to filter out any file or directory, still that can be given by using relevant patterns which have to be filtered off. All these were discussed in listing the files and path filters, which followed the topic. And if you want to delete any data, you can quickly delete the data by using delete, specify the file path, and Boolean recursive. A non-empty directory is deleted along with its contents only if this recursive is set to true. Otherwise, IO exception will be thrown because the directory is empty. And in the next next lecture, we have seen the most important part of this module, that is the anatomy of file read and write. Okay, I'll quickly go through this anatomy of file read and write. So when a HDFS client wants to read a file from the HDFS cluster, which is located on the file system on the HDFS cluster, then initially it gives a open command to distributed file system, which in turn gives an RPC call, that is remote processor call, to the name node in order to get the blocks of data, details about the blocks of data where that file is actually distributed. So this name node starts with the initial blocks of data where the file is actually residing. So this distributed file system will create an FS input stream file system and hands it over to HDFS client. Now this HDFS client in turn gives a read call to FS input stream, which in turn encapsulates another object of distributed file system input stream. Now this distributed file system input stream will in turn call the data nodes where the data is actually residing. It just gives a read command. Calling in the sense, it gives a read command to the data node where the blocks of data is residing. But if at all a data is corrupted on a particular data node, it immediately notifies the name node that that particular data node is corrupted and will not attempt to call it again in order to read the data. Now this name node again gives the address of another name node where that copy of that block is available. So when this distributed data input stream finishes reading the blocks of data available on all these data nodes, HDFS client again calls a close method on that particular input stream so that the entire operation will be completed. Now, if at all a data node fails in between, immediately it will be notified to the name node in order to get the block that is available on a different healthy data node. Okay, that is what happens in a file read. Now, how file writes are performed. In file, when HDFS client wants to write a file to file system on HDFS, first it generates a create method, create call on distributed file system, and this distributed file system in turn requests name node to create a new file with a specific name. Now this name node sees whether this HDFS is authorized to create a file on the HDFS file system or not. If he is authorized and if no such file is existing with the same name, then name node creates a space on the file system for that file to be created. Now this distributed file system in turn creates another object for distributed data output stream. Hands over the object to FS data output stream, which in turn encapsulates, wraps a distributed data output stream, which keeps track of two different queues. One is called the data queue and the other one is the acknowledgement queue. Now these two, the data that has to be written onto the data nodes is passed in form of packets into the data queue, which will start writing it to the data nodes that are allotted by the name node. Now, if at all one name node collapses in this case, if a data node fails in this case, then immediately that will be notified to the name node, and name node selects another data node which is healthy and puts it into the pipeline of the data nodes, write pipeline of the data nodes. Now, whenever a data node failure occurs, this data queue will just stop writing, and all the acknowledgement queue packets will be added to the front of the data queue so that the next coming data node will not miss any packets that are already written to a failed node. So that this under replication, because one data node among three data nodes is failed, so there are only two data nodes to maintain the replication factor as two. In this case, the third replication factor is also met. The third copy is also created to meet the replication factor 3 by the data node by creating another healthy, by sending another healthy data node into the write pipeline of these data nodes. Okay, such that the default replication factor is met. Now, when all the data packets are written onto the data nodes, this distributed data output stream notifies the name node that the write operation is completed and flushes all the remaining packets in the data queue onto the data nodes, so that the HDFS client once again calls the close operation or close method on FS data output stream to close all the output streams or input streams that are opened during the task. This completes the write operation. Okay. And in the later parts, we have seen coherency model, where it helps to keep track of the read and write operations that are performed on the HDFS cluster. Okay, in this part, we have seen how a coherency model describes the data visibility of reads and writes for a file. When they are being written, can we keep track of their status? That is enabled by this coherency model. And I have explained various code snippets which will be helpful to us in order to keep track of the status. And parallel copying using a disk CP, where you can copy data from one HDFS cluster to other HDFS cluster, or from one name node to other name node. How this CP helps in this? They are also explained by taking, if Hadoop runs on the same, I'll show you the exact command. Yeah, in this case, Hadoop is running the same versions on both the name node clusters. In that case, you can use the same URI as in this case, what we have given. Here, we have given the same URI, Hadoop, HDFS, and HDFS here. That is for the source name node and the destination name node. From which source name node you're copying the file, to the destination name node to where you are copying the file. In both the cases, you can use the same URI HDFS if Hadoop is running identical versions, but if it is running different versions, then they may not be compatible. In that case, what you can do is you can use one URI with the source cluster and a separate URI with the destination cluster. In this case, if you use both URIs same, it will not work. It will raise errors. In that case, you may have to, in previous case, when you have used HDFS, that will raise incompatibility issues. But if you have a version like HFTP, a file system concrete implementation like HFTP, in that case, it will be useful for us to give different URIs for the source name node and the destination name node. In this case, we can use HFTP for the source cluster and HDFS for the destination cluster. So this HFTP will resolve any incompatibility issues in URI if Hadoop is running two different versions, running on two different versions. And another solution for this is to use WebHDFS, where it resolves incompatibility between these two source and destination clusters URIs by using same WebHDFS here as well as here. Okay, this is how DISCP can be run even on Hadoop, which is running on different versions. And later we have seen HDFS cluster balancing, how to balance HDFS cluster by dividing the map nodes appropriately onto various data nodes, and Hadoop archives, how you can store the historical data in the Hadoop archives. Okay, this completes the walkthrough through module 4. If you have any doubts on this, you can ask me.
No doubts, ma'am.
No doubts?
No doubts.
Okay, okay. We'll end this meeting then. All the best for your exam.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Bye.
Bye, ma'am.
Bye.